over to the book of Hebrews, if you read chapter 12, if you'll mark that, just a moment, we're going to go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 12, and mark it, we're going to leave there, but we're going to come back to the end of Hebrews chapter 12 again. If you follow along with me as we look at the scriptures this morning, Hebrews chapter 12 in your Bible, and again, thank you for your faithfulness. I haven't had a chance to tell you thank you personally. I'm just going to remind you of two things. One, I mentioned last week, was the great privilege of living to please God, not men. Living to please men is the most frustrating thing in life. The people are specific. And you go through life like a politician, a double standard, always trying to juggle what you believe to make people happy. You know what? A great leader is when you just step back and say, you know what? I don't care. I'm going to make God happy, and it just doesn't matter to anybody else. There's a wonderful liberty, there's a confidence that comes, there's a joy that comes. Not even everybody's going to like you, but if you compromise, everybody's not going to like you. So why not have God happy and let the rest of the world go wherever they're going to go? But I have a great 2013 last year. One thing it said that we would not be mean pleasers. And the second thing was that the joining this year to be aware of the joy that every circumstance that comes to you comes through the hands of a loving God. And that God is using those things to make you more like Christ. He's not punishing me. He's not after me. He's not against me. But God is taking these things and he's molding and shaping me into Christ like me. Just those two thoughts will help you go into this year, give you a lot better year. And then, if you catch this morning, Hebrews chapter 12, how to find happiness in 2013. Let's stand for a moment and read the scripture. If you're going to slip out, I say this often, but please slip out now. Get a seat in the back. Let's don't disturb each other. We've just got a few minutes for the preaching of God's Word, and we rush God's ways. If I had my way, I'd get to preach 2 hours every Sunday morning, 2 hours every Sunday night, and eat for 2 hours every Sunday afternoon. But none of those are possible. Verse 1 of Hebrews 12, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. And here's our text verse or this phrase, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Looking at Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. That last line in verse 12, let us run with patience the race set before us. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that we could be here this morning. Thank you for your word and the clear guidance of it. What a great thing, what a privilege to have your book in our hands, the book that you wrote, the book that you offered, that you gave to us today, just exactly what we need. Bless us as we look at it today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Keep your Bible open there. And when we leave for Hebrews, mark it, because we're going to come back in here, and I don't have time to get to Hebrews twice in one day. We find there in the end of verse 1, it says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. The early part of the verse, two or three sermons, a lot of doctrine there. But I want you to notice, number one, three simple points this morning. Number one this morning, there is a race, a plan. There is a course for each one of you. It says, let us run with patience the race, that individual race set before us. And you know what? interpret for the deaf. That's not my race. But aren't you glad if you're hearing impaired in America, aren't you glad some of you learn how to do sign language? That's a race to run where you can honor God with your fingers. And that's a good thing. And if you could teach every lady to do more with your fingers and not with their mouth. I'm not going to go off on that. My wife is sick this morning, so she's not here. I was going to talk about my favorite part of my wife's kitchen. I'm not listening to them, but anyway, there's single people here. We won't go that far. Yes, old people do care. When their teeth fall out, they don't. There's a plan. God's got a plan for you, a plan for your life. And every lady, every man, every young person, every old person, like 55-year-old, God's got a plan. And he says, let us run with patience the race set before us. Now, this morning, God has got a race set out there for me. He's got one for you. And your race is here, and mine's here. They're all different. I'm not running against you. I'm running to finish my course, as you see in a minute or two. But God set this out. Now, way back in 1975, I got saved. That was when the starting gun went off. God, when I accepted Christ as Savior, at that moment, I started my race for God. Now, all the training, the fact that my dad left when I was a boy, and a lot of things I went through, we'll talk a little bit about that tonight, but the things in our background, God knows, God's found it. There's no accident. The fact that this morning you're a single parent. The fact that this morning you may have come from a rougher background and maybe you have a very good education and somebody else had a very bad education. God's not dead. God knows where you came from. God knows you immigrated to this country or your parents did. God knows that you your work has never seemed to fall into place. You've always scraped and scrimped to try and pay the bills. God knows all that. God knows you're a soldier. God knows that you're you're a wife of a soldier who's deployed a lot, and you spend half your married life alone, and while they're off shooting pool and surfing and doing all the fun things soldiers do.
But God's got a course for you. God's got a course for you. Understand, number one this morning, there is a plan. There's a purpose. There's something specific God designed for you to do and to be. Now, keep your that place marked to go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We're going to come back to you in a moment. How do we get this thing of happiness? How do we find it? We all want it. And it could be happiness, joy. There's different terms this morning. It's very loosely defining the term. How do we have that internal peace and happiness in this year? 1 Corinthians 9. You find that for me this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Now, while you're looking for 1 Corinthians 9, Corinth is in that area of the world. They were very near to the Olympic Games. They were the founders in that whole area. That's where the Olympics came from, the Colosseums in the Greece and Athens and Corinth, that whole area. They were very familiar with fighting and with running and with, when they fought, it was better than just ultimate wrestling. I mean, they carried out the dead bodies of the guys that lost. They fed them to lions. These were people that understood sports and athletics. They understood war. They were warriors. They were soldiers. And so Paul, as he wrote, used a lot of illustrations that were athletic. He talked about wrestling. We wrestled not against flesh and blood. He talked about so fight I. We're going to read in a moment. He's already finding 1 Corinthians 9, all right? But so that's why we're coming into this story here. Look at 1 Corinthians 9 and look at verse 26. I therefore so run. So that's the illustration, like running a race. Not as uncertainly. But if you've ever run, a race you weren't sure. I ran cross country in high school just for conditioning. And sometimes you get out and you're not sure, there's a turn. And we've run a 5-mile cross country course before workouts, and then we go run it again at the end. But if you were new, you follow the path. But if you got in the front, which I never did, or you got in the very far back, which I never did, you didn't know where a turn was. Well, that's that uncertainty. He said in verse 26, I therefore so run not as uncertainly. He said, I know where I'm going, I know what I'm doing, and I'm going to give it my all. In the next phrase, so fight I. Again, using the athletic and the Olympic type illustration, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Years ago, we were at the Colorado River, and we go on these trips there, and now I'm being grouped out, and it's not handling anymore. But I said, you two young guys want to go, I'd take you. But we'd go spend 3 days just floating on the Colorado River, being absolute idiots, filling water balloons with anything thing you could get inside and throw them in that thing with the other boats. And, you know, a water balloon filled with soda pop and coffee grounds makes a great impression on people. But anyway, great times on the Colorado. But somebody one year brought boxing gloves. I don't know why they did it. It was not intelligent. No mouthpieces, no head pieces, no nothing in the head either. And people were boxing, and here I am, somebody wanted to send a match fight, and this newer guy came, and we're boxing, and I've not boxed a lot, a little, but I got a lucky punch in and caught him on the jaw, and just dropped him. And I thought, there's a tiger. Oh, I hate it when that happens. And one of our other guys, he worked his boss, and we both came on the trip. And so now he's boxing his boss, and all of a sudden the boss has got a busted nose, blood going everywhere. And I said, "What are you thinking? He's your boss." And he said, "I didn't hit him. I simply put my fist where his face was going." He was a fighter. He knew what he was doing. No one should have let him fight. And I lost a fighter, and he was unemployed. And the boss had a broken nose, and the other guy joined the church. But anyway, but you know what? Typically, when you're doing things with your friends, you don't hit as hard, or you don't wrestle as big. You want to win, but when he says there, so fight I, not as one that beat us to air. That's fighting a punching bag. That's wrestling, sparring, but you're not really intending to knock anybody out. That's kind of a more casual thing. Well, the Apostle Paul says, I therefore so run, not as uncertainly. I know my course. I know what I'm doing. I'm giving it all. And I fight not as somebody who's sparring. I'm in for the kill. I'm going with all that I've got. I'm going to do this thing. I am running my race. Verse 27. Notice this. But I keep under my body. I've got this race. I'm giving it my all. I'm fighting for everything it's worth. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection. Why? Lest that by any means when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway. Paul said, I'm on my course. Back there, I got saved, and God has a course for me individually to run. And yet, while I run and preach to others, if I let this body go and do what it wants to do, I may forfeit my race. And lest that by any means, verse 27, when I preach to others, I myself should be a castaway. Now, that doesn't mean you're not saved anymore. It's like an old pair of shoes. You know, you have nice tennis shoes, and you're careful with them, and you don't wear them out to mow the lawn, and you don't wear them to dig a ditch. But if they get dirtier and worn and old, you start using them for dirtier things and dirty things, and pretty soon, they're still dirty. You're not using them anywhere. And they kind of sit on the shelf until they get, you know, tossed out. And here these shoes are on the shelf that they're so dirty that you wouldn't wear them anyway. Dirt in your own, you put your clean socks, clean feet in the shoe, and your feet are dirty from the shoe. And that's what Paul's talking about. Lest that by any means, when I preach to others, I myself should now be put on the shelf, and God wouldn't use me anymore. Now, let's go back to number one. Hebrews 12 says, there's one that takes the race, that individual race set before you. You're 40 years old, you're 20 years old, you're 14 years old, you're 84 years old, and there's a race. And your race is not my race. And obviously, as you get older, God modifies the course you run. You get a great soldier, a general, doesn't fight and doesn't do the same things in military work as a new enlisted guy. Their bodies are different. Their brains are better, perhaps, hopefully. But as you get older and more experienced, God alters the course. It's not a thing. It's really your course. As you age, God's got this plan for you. You're not an old me to God. You're not a what am I going to do with that with God. You end up in a wheelchair. You end up with oxygen tanks. You end up with some kind of disease. You can't drive, and you're not able to get out at night. So God knows your course. God's got the thing. Look, your job, and we'll get more into it in a minute, your job is to run your race. And secondly, understand as you run that race, there are things you can do with this body that God will pick you up out of your race and put you on the shelf. You will not be able to run your race anymore. Most of us who've been in church much know of preachers who forfeited their race because of something they did with their body. And all kinds of things that happened. Years ago, we started a church. I don't remember who it was. A young man. Somebody lifted off that intestine or something. He just turned around and just turned out of punch. I fell back. They sat in a bumper of a car when bumpers were fewer, and they made real cars. But anyway, and the car, the car fell apart. No, basically, it was the car didn't fall apart, knocked the guy out. And the guy was hitting him, and he went to the hospital, was terrible, he nearly died. It wasn't from the punch, it was from where his head hit, but the guy was hitting him in jail for a year. For a year, our law took him out of this earthly place that we accept. I put him in jail for a year while his body did something. Now, you be careful. You understand what the Apostle Paul, if you're not careful, look, if Paul the Apostle said, I guard my body, I keep under my body, I hang on to this thing, and look, I've got a course to run. It's my race. No one else can run my course. And I keep this body in subjection. And if I don't, God might put me in a jail. Look, if the Apostle Paul is concerned, you better be concerned. If the Apostle Paul is concerned, I better be concerned. Better men than you, and better men than me, and better ladies than you. And not better ladies than me, because there's no lady better than me as the lady, because I'm not a lady. But anyway, by the way, you are one or the other. But anyway, this matter of running this course, better men than you and me have failed and been set aside. Better Christians in their performance, better Christians. I mean, the Apostle Paul wrote half our New Testament. The Apostle Paul started churches all over. And here he is starting churches and preaching and doing incredible things for God. Paul says, I don't want to lose it. What if I should let my body go and get off into immorality? What if I should let go to drugs or liquor? And what if I should let go to some shameful deed or some illegal deed? What if I should do that? Now, Paul ended up in jail. When he says, jail's not wrong, if you end up in jail and drop the gospel. Half of our New Testament was written from jail. And I'll get to that in a minute. But you got to understand, where you are doesn't matter if you stay on course for God. What God's called you to do. We have soldiers and airmen, different people involved in the military, and you might be another continent, and you might be across the world. Look, if that's where the work, the government, the country takes you, well, that's your course. But just make sure you're a Christian while you're there. Paul said, I have a course to run. Number one, everybody's got a course. Your course. Different from each other. And everybody's got one. You're not unusual. How do you start it? You start it back here whenever you accept Christ as Savior. When you get saved, God starts it. The gun fires and the race is on and you're supposed to run, not as uncertainly. So fight on, not as one that beat at the air. You ought to give it your all and run your race. Number two, understand, it's a dangerous race that you could lose the privilege of running and you could be put on the shelf. Now, a parenthesis here, by the way, God can take those old dirty shoes off and wipe them down and put them back on anytime he wants. So if by chance you've been on the shelf, get off it. Don't pout up there on the shelf. Well, with me, I'm on the shelf. Look, how many people we've seen in the Bible? Every kind of crime imaginable committed by people that God put back into his work. So don't sit on your shelf pouting. Now, God may rewrite your course. He may take you from the 5-mile cross-country course and put you in the hurdles or put you in a sprint or a shot put. But your course, look, you're not done. If you're breathing, you have a course. You have a course today. And God's got a plan for your life. And nobody can mess that up but you. And if you get put in a shelf because of you, you can get off that shelf back in the hands of God and run your race.
For the glory of God. The fact is, Paul was concerned about being set on the shelf, and so should I. Number one, there is a race that God's got for you and for me. Number two, there is an opportunity, often many opportunities, on this earth that I could do something that would cause me to miss that path. Why is it that liquor and drugs and divorce and immorality and craziness runs rampant in Hollywood? I'll tell you why.
And not in Hollywood. In the music industry, in the athletic industry, because there's some people God's got a course for. But they didn't want God's course. They want to do their own thing. And when their own thing didn't make them happy, see, happiness comes on the course. You get on the course that God's given to you, and God pours happiness down from heaven. Because happiness isn't all the earthly things you think of. Happiness comes from heaven. That's why a poor person can be happy. That's why a young person who rides a bus and comes to Sunday school and church can be happy. And somebody who drives a beautiful Mercedes or a Ferrari, I saw a Maserati yesterday in downtown Oakland. I thought, that's a misplaced car. But anyway, it was obviously stolen. That car didn't get happening to you. And so here you are. You're on your course, and you turn from that course that will bring happiness, and I'll show you why it brings happiness in a minute. And they try to find happiness in things. Some 14-year-old girl, a cute girl with a good voice. And somebody finds her and says, you know what? I can make sense of you. They go to her parents. We can make your daughter famous and rich. And suddenly her face is on CD albums and the internet and posters and billboards. And they start putting, pretty soon she's on a Walmart brand of skirts or something. I don't know what. She becomes famous. Watch it. You give her 3 or 4 years, she'll be rich. Give her 4 or 5 more years, she'll be immortal. Why? Because fame never brings happiness. She'll get money, and then she's going to be sleeping around, married, divorced, kids, drugs, no kids, liquor. Where is the Britney Spears? And you can name them if you want to go back 20 years to the little music icons of this world. They're not bad people. They got off their course. And when they got off their course, they started trying to find happiness anywhere but in the will of God. And out here, well, when this drug didn't work, I'll take more drugs. And when this didn't work, I'll drink more of that. And when this didn't work, I'll sleep around with this girl, or that girl. And all the moral depravity in America. Why? Because they're not in the course that God called them to be on. Happiness is right there in the will of God. Number one, God's got a plan for your life. And on that course, it's a wonderful course. Number two, there are things you can do with your body that will cause you to be off that course. What is wrong with the drugs and the liquor and the shameful living? He said, oh, it's bad for your health. Oh, forget that. It's bad for the will of God. Well, if you know, you smoke, you might get cancer and die. I plan on dying. Sooner or later. Right? And maybe years of that, that'll get you to go a little sooner. You know, the biggest thing you want to do is stay on that course. Stay on that course. Stay on that course. The moral shame. If I mess up too much in my morals, God will say, you're not glorifying me. God will pick me up, put me over there. The Kobe Bryant of this world, the LeBron James of this world, you know what? They're messing up. I'll tell you why. They have moral problems and money problems. And you watch the next decade of their life, the frustration of their life. Say the problem, they should be right over here. I don't think it's basketball. Kobe Bryant might have been teaching Sunday school this morning somewhere. We're in the Christian basketball camp somewhere during the offseason. Yeah, he's teaching the Word of God to people. And he ought to be living his life for God. Play ball. Look, if you're a computer trainer, a program writer, or you're a soldier of some kind, or you're an, I don't care if you're a politician. No, I don't think any politician can be saved. I'm joking. A lot of great Christian politicians. But be on your course. But don't do anything on that course that would cause you to be set on the shelf. But also understand the world out there, they're looking for money and fame and success and wealth. And they're trying, and you know what they're trying to happen to them. So what they do is they want more of it. And they want more of it, and they want more of it. And explain something happens. This whole matter of who you are. When you put on a uniform as a soldier, any kind of a listen, I don't know if this is universal for all of the oaths of office, but this is the oath that when you are enlisted into the military, you say these words, I do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. That means it's a domestic enemy. Now, I believe in that. That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same. That I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me according to the regulations of the Uniform Code of Military Justice. So help me God. Now, let me explain something. When you put on that uniform, you that were military, you that are, and you that may one day be military, you just lost who you are. You now represent that flag. You now represent the United States of America. And when you go across the world to wherever you go, look, the first thing that happens, take a bunch of young men, 20, 30, 40, 50 young men, and you drop them all off in the boot camp somewhere. You know what they do? They shave all your hair off, and they take all your clothes off. You know why? Zero identity. Because you're no longer you. You're now a representative of the United States of America. And you now have one responsibility, and that responsibility is to follow the directives of your nation's leader and whoever he puts underneath him, and you are to represent that flag across the world. You don't have a right to your own will if you've not listened to Colonel Bo Bottomley. His books and his audio books are in our bookstore. You got to get them. In fact, somebody's going to this news conference reminding me you got to use those this weekend. But Colonel Bo, he's spoken here several times. He's about 120 years old. And he lives up in Iowa, and Colonel Bo was a fighter pilot in World War II. And then he was a fighter pilot in Korea, and then he was a fighter pilot in Vietnam. He progressed from the prop planes to the jets. And in Vietnam, he's still not a Christian, this guy. He saw some pretty ugly things happen. He saw some injustice. He saw wrong, the political correctness happening that cost some very, very good soldiers their lives. And he got more and more mad. He got angry. And one day, I don't know how he did it, but he got his plane loaded with all the armament he could, and without anybody's permission, he took that plane, that jet, and headed north, blowing things up. Jesus name. He blew up villages, he blew up everything. I mean, he just went off, he took it upon himself to declare war. We don't have a right to declare war. But when he got done blowing everything up, there was one problem. He had to go back to that same other. And there were people waiting for him when he got back. And they did not turn the medals on. And miraculously, he went through the whole thing, and he was going to be court-martialed. It was during that day, during those days, that he got saved. His son, who was in America, had gotten saved. On his phone, he led his daddy to Christ over in Saigon or wherever he was over there. And Colonel Bo, you know what he did wrong? He was supposed to be representing that flag. But instead, he was representing himself. One of the big wrongs in Christianity, August 28, 1975, I signed my induction papers. When I accepted Christ as Savior, I stepped into the Lord's army. And my uniform, my exterior as well as my interior belongs to Him. And the great wrong is when I look at the course God has. On this course, I'm to glorify God, not me. And so I get out here wanting to show how much glory I can get. And I'm out here as an actor or a singer or an athlete, and I'm trying to get all the glory or the attention. I'm just trying to get money. I'm out here for money and wealth. I'm out here for position and power. I'm out here for prestige. Young people in Bible college, you young men who might preach one day. You want the great liberties of life? Is where I stand right now. I don't have to please anybody but God Almighty. I'm not here, and if you say, you know what, you say this and such, I'm not coming back. Write it down, I'll read it, and you can go somewhere else next week. I don't care. I'm a free man. It's not about me. I'm in his uniform. I'm under his orders. I swore allegiance to my God. I represent a kingdom over in Hebrews, he says. So they look for a city whose builder and ruler is God. I represent the King of Glory. I'm in the most wonderful liberty as I walk this path that God set before me. I don't have to worry about anybody. You know what? I take my marching orders from my commander in chief, who's never wrong. What an incredible honor to represent the King of Glory. All of his orders are good, and all of his orders are right. And sometimes you get shot, but it's okay, because we're going to get home, we'll get to the other end. But as soon as I get off his course, and I start seeking my own will, or we're on his course and things don't go our way. A few weeks ago, we were $100,000 upside down on our property, and there was no way of getting out of the economic pressures we were under. We began to pray. And I'm over in New Zealand. The guy says, up at our house. Told my wife, I could sell this. And she said, you don't know how much you owe. He said, tell me. And he said, I get it. I can do it. And 24 hours later, we had a cash offer for our property. 24 hours. 14 days later, it closed escrow, cash. I mean, I wrote the most, if you know anything about the disclosures you have to write on your property, I wrote down everything. You didn't know me. They turned the video off, right? There might have been something done that property. It was not permitted. The one house about 100 years old, and anyway, we won't do that. It's all fine and dandy and safe and legal and just and the proper and all that kind of good stuff. But there's just a whole lot. I wrote
say in defense and broken down and this and that. I will have any feet of a discouraged guy, and you don't want it because of this, and this. And I'm not fixing none of it, and I'm not giving you any money to fix it, and you can like it or lump it. I get no better. Happily to accept your offer. And God's got to be in this thing. And on that sort of story, I go down to San Francisco papers. This is 14 days after the 50 days after the list. I'm down to Nicholas. I walk into an office. I'm on my course. Understand, every child of God has got a race to run. I'm on my race. My wife beside me. And we're signing extra papers. Next to me is a lovely lady from the extra company. We get talking to her, and I'm going to talk about Christ. Look, we're talking about tons of money being exchanged against here. I know she's going to get more than I am because it costs me. But anyway, we got talking a little bit about the Lord. Found out she grew up in a Baptist church. She was saved. We got talking some more wonderful stories. She said, and where do you go to church? She said, you know, a few years ago, my mom got this to me. My wife now, she's on her course. A good lady. She said, I watched my mom suffer on Sunday morning. She said, then my daughter got cancer and was born. Beautiful young lady. And these two fingers, she lost those all the way back to the wrist. And I was lucky. I saw them two fingers in the same hand. She said, you know, I just couldn't take it. She said, I don't take things. She talked, cried. She hugged him from the way of office, my wife. When I left that office, my opinion was honored. And she was thinking how good that was. So our world, I had a conversation with the father talking about our son, going to be tested. And that's how I started. No, look, I can't fix what my son's going through. I may not be able to. I may be knocking on your door while you use the extra bedroom down the road here. But I'm staying on the course. You know what I don't want? I don't want to get rid of down the right place. Now, why not? Because it's not about me. It's about my comfort. It's about my comfort. It's not just me as a soldier, Marines, Air Force. It's about your nation. It's about your president. It's about your kingdom. It's about the nation you represent. You have no right to go AWOL. Let me tell you something. As a child of God, I'm on this course. And the step, number one, is the course God set for me. Number two, on that course, there are things I can do that will get me put on the shelf. Things I can do in my body. Things I can get involved in. Things I can dishonor God. My job, look, you read the stories of soldiers and special forces, these people here, and Rangers, and SEAL team, this and that. But those stories are not all good stories. But you know what? They're there. They're representing their country. They're representing their nation. They're doing their job. Is it all the same? No. Is it all fair? No. It's what they've been called to do. And so you and me, when we get saved, God lays a course before us. Every one of us has a course. Is our course the same as each other? No. Is it all easy? No. Is there injustice? Yes, there's injustice. Will we weep through some things? Yes, we will. Will we like where we are? No, we won't. Let me show you this. Look at me in your Bibles over the book of 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. Now, there's a difference you'll see. We're going to go to Hebrews in just a minute. We read in 1 Corinthians where Paul said, I therefore still run, not as uncertain, still fight, I'm not as one that beats the air. But I keep under my body Paul, present tense. I therefore so run. I fight, not as one that beats the air. It's today. Paul's fighting 1 Kings 9:27. But look over with me, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. You hear that? 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. Something happened between Corinthians and 2 Timothy 4. Look at verse 6. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. How about my discharge papers are about to be signed? He said,
says, if you look at verse 6, I am now ready to be offered. Let's pretend the piano is the end of Paul's life when he begins breathing celestial air and no longer faces the battles of flesh and the battles of this world. And Paul says, it's in sight. And I'm now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. Now look what he said. Look at the tense of it. I have fought a good fight. Past, present, or future. I have fought a good fight. Look at this fight. I have finished my course. I have, past tense, kept the faith. Now back here in 1 Corinthians 9:27, Paul says, I therefore so run, present tense. So fight I, present tense. Not as uncertainly, not as one that beats the air, but I keep under my body, present tense. Why? Lest I should be a castaway. Why? Because, look at the next line in 2 Timothy 4:7. I think it's therefore.
I don't know if you find it. All I know is what it says. He says, henceforth there is laid up for me. See that? Verse 8, I think. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Paul is about to reach over and take that heavenly narrative to him. He's looking back to him. When they lied about me and beat me, I kept my faith. When Demas, my co-worker, took off because he wasn't getting paid enough, I kept my faith. When my good friends I left behind because they were sick, I could heal strangers, but I couldn't heal my co-worker. And I had to leave him behind. But I stood before the judge, and all of my Christian friends went with me. I kept my faith. Paul said, man, I know that, man. Those nights in the ship, and the storm, you rocked the dog. The storm was so bad, they named it. We named it hurricanes. And Paul said, terrible storm. We're throwing everything overboard with our hands, trying to lighten the ship so we can make it. And finally, they said, kill all the prisoners. And I said, no, you're out of prison. I said, no, Captain, it'll be fine. We're all going to live. We're going to lose the ship. We'll all be fine. And the captain took my word as a prisoner over the word of the other soldiers. Well, I remember that and how we came on quicksand and we got onto that island and got to heal the chief of the disease he had. And the snake came out of the fire of the wood. And I picked the wood up and I just shook it off. Remember Philip Pinero, shake it off. Man, that's great. You got to hear that if you haven't. And he said, you shook it off and went on about his business. And Paul is reaching for the nail pierced hand. He said, I never lost my faith. Did things go easy? No. It's junk. Well, the prison cell good? No, he wrote from prison cell. I remember writing from the prison cell, bring the cloak. I'm cold. But don't forget the parchment. Paul says, man, in that jail cell, it's cold. I don't have a Bible to read. And miserable there, but you know, I won Onesimus. I won Onesimus because sending back to Philemon where I started church in the city of Colossae. Paul was reaching out. He said, time of my departure is at hand. I fought a good fight. I finished the course. But this fight wasn't punching out somebody. This fight was keeping his faith in God in everything. Henceforth, he says in verse 8, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. But look at the end. Which he has promised not only to me, but to those also. That means to you.
Henceforth, there's laid up for me in verse 8 a crown of righteousness that the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give. I'll find it. It's in here somewhere. It's in front of you. You can read it. Why do I have to read it? You got a Bible. Henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness that the Lord, the righteous judge, whatever he says there in verse 8, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them also. That's you, who love his appearing. You know this morning, you may be back here a little further. I'm 55 years old. I think I'm pretty young, but I played some volleyball and basketball on New Year's Day, and my knee still hurts, so I don't feel quite like I did 20 years ago. But I think I've got another decade or two to hit this thing. But some of you that are back there, hey, keep the pace, man. Stay tight. Then fight the good fight. Finish the course. I'm looking to others who are down the road, like Brother Mitch McMahon and other senior Christians who are up there a little closer, and they've got some race yet to run, but I'm looking at them seeing, man, I want to follow in their footsteps. I want to finish my course. But look at this.
Look at verse 6. I'm sorry. Yes, verse 8. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day, not to me only, but to all them also who love his appearance. God says there is something wonderful waiting for you. That's what we're going to do. Paul says, I'm ready. Like, look what happened. You're looking for Hebrews 12 while I'm finishing up the story here. The Apostle Paul, back in Corinthians, he's having to fight today. That's who you are. He's having to run his race and fight the good fight. And Paul says another spot, he said, so I might finish my course with joy. But now Paul, in Timothy, he's about to get, see, where are you in this thing? You know what you want to get? You don't need to never have anything go wrong. You need to never lose your faith. You get out there to that end of the Jesus, you will be so glad you kept your faith. Now, this matter of joy, look at Hebrews chapter 12, and we'll finish right here. Number one, I said there's a race, there's a plan. There is a prepared purpose for your life. Something specific God designed you to do. Number two, there are things in this earth you can do that will get you off the course. There are things that will get you off the course and put on the shelf so that you cannot run your race. I said that if you can get off the shelf, yield your life to God, and God will put you back in the race, or God will write a new race for you. And then number three, and in closing with this, there's real joy and happiness found only on that course. Hebrews 12, look at me at verse 2. The last line of verse 1 is Hebrews 12. It says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Hebrews 12, 1, right again. So we've all got a race. So look at verse 2. Looking unto Jesus. So how am I supposed to run this course? I'm going back to a college dormitory with 19 feet of snow on the ground, and it won't be above zero until July. And the day the snow goes away, mosquitoes are hatched out big enough that two of them can carry you off and nurse their babies from your veins. I never saw mosquitoes like the Midwest. I mean, anybody who would settle in Iowa, Kansas, Nebraska, Indiana, Illinois, California, here I come, man. You open up the Golden Gates and all that stuff, but you finish your course. How do you do it? Looking into Jesus, verse 2. Looking into Jesus. Looking into Jesus. But what are we looking at? Who? Now look at that verse with me. Look at verse 2. Who for the joy that was set before him? What? Joy? No. Was the cross a joy? Was the beating a joy? Was the hatred a joy? No, it wasn't a joy. The joy was who for the joy that was set before him. What did he do? He endured the cross and despised the shame. He hated it. And I believe that today there's some wonderful Christians, probably some in this room, who are on their course, and you despise what you're having to go through. There may be some things that humiliate you. It says he despised the shame. You go back here 33 years in his life, you go back just a few days in his life. He's 33 years old. He wasn't just crucified. It wasn't a cute little thing. They stripped him naked. They beat his body with a cat of nine tails, put a crown of thorns on his face. Trained soldiers pounded and beat and abused him. They put a purple robe on him, and they drug him out in front of that giant crowd on that balcony, and they said, behold the man. Here the creator of the universe stood just beaten to a pulp. A crown of thorns, a purple robe. Soul gold, lewd, horrible things on the earth. And they laughed at him. They beat him with a cat of nine tails till his insides were almost shredded out completely out of his body. They drag him up the road to Calvary. They pull his beard out. They spit on him. They nail his hands and his feet to the cross. And they hang him there, stripped completely naked. And it says, and they sit him, they sat down and watched, like they watch a man. It says that he was 12 feet, he was 5. Look at verse 2 again. Looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, he said, the joy that was set before him, and
endured the cross, despising the shame, and has stepped down at the right hand. Where's the joy? The joy is not the cross. He hated the cross. The joy was not the shame. He hated the embarrassment. But for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despised the shame. And now what? He's just like I said, the Apostle Paul. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Into thy hand I commend my spirit. And he gave up the ghost. And instantly our Lord took our sins. He spent bodily 3 days down in the grave. His soul is there. They lead in captivity captive, Ephesians 4:9. And what he gave gifts and men, what the pastors and evangelists, and all the wonderful gifts the church comes from. And what a wonderful day. And he goes up 3 days later to the mercy seat in heaven, and he puts the blood on the mercy seat. And there on that mercy seat, our sins are eternally atoned for. And Jesus sits down next to the Heavenly Father. And joy in your life, you know what? You make me so happy. You make me so happy to know what you're doing.
Bernie Paulson was a music professor in Iowa Bible College. Dr. Paulson was in the Pacific in World War II on a battleship. He said that many times the North Pacific is so rough that the cannons, the guns, excuse me, I'm not a military guy, it goes so far they dip in the water here and dip in the water there. And the guys would be down below deck, playing cards, telling jokes, being filthy, being stupid. He said he'd go up on deck and take apart his gun, his palm deck, and take apart whatever kind of gun he saw. Said, I'd take this thing apart, put it in every part, put it all back together, make sure he was ready to go for action. He said, one day he's out there, sunshine, very comfortable day on deck. It was his free time, and he was stripping his weapon and putting it all together and cleaning it and everything. And he said, I just sensed. Father essentially looked up several decks above him with the commanding officer leaning on the rail. He said, commanding officer, he said, I want to get out of here with my own eyes. In the midst of whatever battle I face, I want to be so behaved that I can look up and see the smile. Doesn't matter how famous you are, well known you are, how pretty you are, girls, you're way, way, you're being brainwashed by the malls. Don't let that get you. It's not the perfect face, the perfect figure, the perfect clothes, and all that. They're all over here, and they're all, you know, these being the perfect will of God. God has a plan for you. Run your race with all your strength. Fight. You don't have to fight each other. You're not fighting your wife. You're not fighting your husband. You're not fighting me. You know who you're fighting? You're fighting the quit that's inside you. You're fighting the despair that's inside you. You're in here and some bad days come and you're fighting the discouragement that's inside you. And like the Apostle Paul looking back to that shipwreck and looking back to the jail, and you're looking back maybe at some things, and you're right now in the middle of some things. You're thinking, what's the point? The point is touching a hand and finding a God. Breathing new air and finding it celestial. Father, bless us today. May we step into this new year running our race, thinking, of course, keeping our faith. Father, what an incredible honor it is that we could be inducted into this family, into the honor of God. We'd ask, Lord, that this morning, as we step into a new year, that every young person, every adult, every senior citizen here realize, I am on a course toward God, and I want to run my race. God, please. And when I walk away from somebody, may it be his name that's honored, not mine. Lord, we live for self-glory.